فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. إن شاء الله تعالى today's lecture is going to be about the ruling of a woman getting married without the permission of her wali, without the consent of her wali, her guardian. This is what the topic is going to be about. So the way, inshallah ta'ala, this lecture is going to be structured is as follows. The first, inshallah ta'ala, sit that we're going to have today, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem, is going to be about an introduction. Today we're going to have an introduction, muqaddimah, a tawti'ah. And that's what we're going to be spending today's session with, an introduction. The second thing, inshallah ta'ala, is, or the first after the introduction, which is the sulb al-mawdu', the actual topic, which is hukm al-nikah bidun al-wali. What's the ruling of a nikah without the consent of the wali, the guardian of the woman? The second is man huwa al-wali fi nikah. The second one is who is the wali in the nikah? Who is the woman's guardian? Who does the sharia consider as a wali? Number three is man huwa al-wali, who is the wali inda faqd al-ab, when the father is absent. The third one is who is the wali when the father is absent. That's the third topic that we're going to be speaking about. The fourth, inshallah ta'ala, is aqsamu awliya al-mar'ah, the types of walis, guardians the woman has. Number five, mas'alatu tawliyah wa tahkim. We're going to be talking about issue called tawliya and tahkim. And what do they mean? And we're going to have a correct perception of it. Then after that, we're going to be speaking about hukmul mawlud, the ruling of the child that is born from the marriage without the permission of the wali. What's the ruling regarding this child? Hukmul mawlud. What is the ruling of the child that is born from this sort of marriage, the marriage that doesn't have the consent and permission of the guardian of the woman? Last but not least, shubuhat, doubts that are brought, and the responses to it, inshallah ta'ala. Responding to each doubt that's brought, giving it a detailed explanation, inshallah ta'ala. So this is how we plan, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem, to talk about this topic and to deal with this particular issue. Okay? Inshallah ta'ala, muqaddimah, introduction. The muqaddimah we're going to speak about is ma huwa al-dalil, what is the evidence? What is a abiding evidence that one has to follow? It's very important. And this is a tawti'ah, a muqaddimah. It's an introduction that when we go into the sulb al-mawdu', when we go into the actual topic, these points, inshallah ta'ala, is going to allow us to not differ bi'idhnillahi al-kareem, and to see eye to eye with one another, and to be in agreement with one another. So what's an evidence? What is it that is abiding and that each and every one of us has to follow? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, اتبعوا ما أنزل إليكم من ربكم ولا تتبعوا من دونه أولياء قليلا ما تذكرون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, اتبعوا, follow, ما أنزل إليكم من ربكم, that which has been sent to you from your Lord. ولا تتبعوا, and do not follow, من دونه, besides Allah, أولياء قليلا ما تذكرون. So this ayah explicitly says to us, follow that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set down. And do not follow besides Allah awliya. Al-Imam Abu Abdullah al-Qurtubi, the great Mufassir, in the explanation of this verse, he says, وَدَلَّتِ الْآيَةُ This ayah has shown عَلَى تَرْكِ To leave off اتِّبَاعِ الْآرَاء وَقَدْ دَلَّتِ الْآيَةُ عَلَى تَرْكِ اتِّبَاعِ الْآرَاء This ayah has shown to leave off following opinions مع وجود النص when there is a text present to leave off following opinions of individuals. So this ayah has shown we have to leave the opinions of individuals and scholars and people of knowledge when there's a evidence present. مع وجود النص, when there's a text there. The text can be الكتاب والسنة والإجماع. The kitab, the sunnah, and the consensus. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says, اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا. Today, I have completed your religion unto you. اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم. Today, I have completed your religion unto you. اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم. وأتممت عليكم نعمتي and I have established my blessing unto you. ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا and I have become pleased with Islam as a religion for you. So this ayah came down the 9th year of the Hijriyah. 3 years before the Prophet ﷺ is about to die. The year the Prophet ﷺ is about to die. The year that the Prophet ﷺ, 10 years of the Prophet in Medina. This is the 10th year of the Hijriyah. Okay? Yawm Arafah. The night of what? Dhul Hijjah. The Prophet ﷺ is in Arafah and he recites this ayah. اليوم today, أكملت لكم دينكم. Today the religion is complete, finished. وأتممت عليكم نعمتي and my blessings I have finished it unto you. ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا and I have become happy with Islam as your religion. Ibn Kathir said regarding this particular verse, when he commented on it, the great scholar Ibn Kathir رحمه الله, he said, هذه أكبر نعم الله عز وجل على هذه الأمة حيث أكمل تعالى لهم دينهم. He said this is from the greatest blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala onto this ummah because he has finished for them their religion. فلا يحتاجون إلى دين غيره and they are not in need of any other religion besides it. ولا إلى نبي غير نبيهم and they are also not in need of any prophet after their prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi ولهذا and because of that جعله الله Allah made the prophet خاتم الأنبياء the final the seal of prophets Allah made him the seal of prophets because of that وبعثه إلى الإنس والجن and Allah sent him to the ins the humans والجن and the jinn. Pay attention here. فَلَا حَلَالَ إِلَّا مَا أَحَلَّهُ There is no halal except that which Allah makes halal and His Messenger. وَلَا حَرَامَ And there is no haram. إِلَّا مَا حَرَّمَهُ Except that which Allah and His Messenger make haram. وَلَا دِينَ And there is no religion. إِلَّا مَا شَرَعَهُ Except that which Allah legislated. So what's a religion? هو ما شرعه الله على ألسنة رسله. Pay attention. If I ask what is the religion of Islam, it's a religion in which Allah legislated everything on the tongue of the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام. So here we learned that the halal and the haram are the khasa'is. Who's uniquely the one who has the right to make something halal and to make something haram? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And which tongue does he make this ruling apparent to us? On the tongue of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So anyone who says something is halal or anyone who says something is haram, he has to what? He has to have brought this from the kitab or the sunnah. He has to have brought it from the kitab and the sunnah. And then the dalil is these. It's the kitab and the sunnah, ijma'ul ummah. The ijma'. So we've benefited something from the kalam of who? Abu Abdullah al-Qurtubi and the kalam of who? Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, based on the two ayah, وَاتَّبِعُوا مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكُمْ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا مِنْ دُونِهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ قَلِيلًا مَا تَذَكَّرُونَ. And also قوله تعالى, اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا. Those two verses, and also with the understanding of those two noble scholars, we have come to know that what? That the evidence is kitab, sunnah and ijma'. The halal and the haram are ahkam, shar'iyya, taklifiyya. Sahih? And they come to us by means of, or through who? The Prophet's tongue, alayhi salatu wasalam. And who is the one who makes those rulings? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now that we've mentioned that point, this topic that we're going to be speaking about, which is حكم النكاح بدون الولي, the woman marrying without the consent of her wali. The scholars have divided into two. The opinion regarding this has become two. Pay attention. The jumhur ulama, the majority of the scholars, the overwhelming majority of scholars are of the opinion that a woman wanting to get married, a prerequisite, a shart that's abiding, that is obligatory on her, is that she has to get the consent of her wali. The jumhur, the overwhelming scholars, are of the opinion, or they state, that it's a shart لِصِحَّةِ النِّكَاحِ, for the validity of the nikah, the consent of the guardian has to be present. There are some scholars who have opposed the jumhur. There are what? There are some scholars who oppose the jumhur al-ulama, the overwhelming majority, such as the great noble imam, Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. The great noble imam, Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'a. May Allah bestow upon him his never-ending mercy. The second is al-Sha'bi, Amir ibn Sharhbil, the great noble imam. He also held the view that it is not a condition for the validity of a marriage. The third one is who? Muhammad ibn Shihab al-Zuhri. Al-Imam al-Zuhri rahimahullah. Those three imams, and I'm just mentioning them, there may be others, but these three are mainly mentions. The majority of the books of fiqh, the majority of the times, these three are mentioned because of their jalala, their nobility and their status, and how strong their statements are in the hearts of the Muslims. Abu Hanifa rahimahullah and al-Sha'bi and al-Zuhri, they opposed the Jumhur. They went against them. And so they said that, but pay attention, there's mawti'u niftifaq, there's mawti'u ittifaq, and there's also a mawti'u Mawtin, which is, there's a niza', there's a discussion and debate about, and there's differences on. They all agree that the woman has a guardian. They are not denying that the woman has a guardian. That's a tifaq, they all agree upon that. But they all differ upon what? And when I say all, I mean Abu Hanifa and Sha'bi and Zuhri on one side, and the Jumhur on the other side. They are differing on what? They are differing on whether it is a shartul li sihhati nikah. If it's a condition for the acceptance of the nikah, the validity of the nikah, if the guardian is a condition like that, a binding condition for the woman's marriage. Now that we have this point, now that we have what we would call a khilaf, is there not a khilaf here? We have a difference of opinion now. We have what? A difference of opinion here. What is the... What is the way that a believer who believes in Allah and the Day of Judgment, the path that he should take? And a person of knowledge. What tariqah is put open for him now? He has one group of scholars, like Abu Harifa and Sha'bi and Zuhri, saying that it is not a shart li sihati nikah. And we have the overwhelming majority of scholars, the Jumhur, on the other side saying what? That it's what? That it's a shart li sihati nikah. Here Allah tabarak wa ta'ala told us what we need to do. Allah says in the Quran, وَمَا اخْتَلَفْتُمْ فِيهِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ فَمْحُكْمُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ. There is nothing you dispute amongst each other with. وَمَا اخْتَلَفْتُمْ فِيهِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. There is مِنْ شَيْءٍ here, nakira. There is not a matter which you differ amongst yourselves with, except فَحُكْمُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ. Except its ruling you find it with Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. When we differ upon an issue, and there's a khilaf amongst our ulama in a matter, the hukum is then with Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولَ وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ فَإِنْ تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ ذَلِكَ خَيْرٌ وَأَحْسَنُ تَأْوِيلًا. Allah says, O those of you who believe, obey Allah and obey the Messenger. And also obey those who Allah has placed authority on you. Are you there? Look at this ayah. There's a very powerful structure that the ayah uses. Allah says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, ati'u Allah. Pay attention. Ati'u Allah, obey Allah. The word ati'u is also repeated again before the Prophet. The whole atf would have sufficed us from that. Allah could have said, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu ati'u Allaha war rasul and obey the Messenger. Pay attention. Pay attention. Allah says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, those of you who believe, ati'u Allaha, obey Allah. Wa ati'u rasul and obey the Messenger. But then when he came to the scholars, what did he say? Wa ulul amri minkum. He didn't say, Wa ati'u ulul amri minkum. The reason is because the obedience of Allah and His Messenger are unrestricted. And their statements are abiding and obligatory for you to follow. As for وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ, those who have authority onto you, who have authority over you, the scholars and the people of knowledge, their obedience is if it's in accordance to the Kitab and the Sunnah. Sahih. And straight after that Allah says, فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ, if you differ and a dispute occurs, في شيء in a matter. Are you with me? فإن تنازعتم. If. Pay attention. فإن تنازعتم في شيء. The dispute can be anything, even if it's a fiqh issue. Because he says في شيء. It's a نكرة. في سياق الشر تفيد العموم. Generalization. What do? فردوه إلى الله والرسول. إن كنتم تؤمنون بالله واليوم الآخر. If you believe in Allah and the Day of Judgment, bring it back to Allah and His Messenger. Ibn al-Qayyim said, how do you bring it back to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once he's dead? He said, it means to bring it back to his Sunnah alayhi salatu wasalam. If he's alive, you take it back to him. Because when the ayah came down, he was alive. So it was that you bring your affairs back to him alayhi salatu wasalam and he will give you an answer. As for bringing it back to the Messenger after he died, it means you bring it back to his Sunnah. But I want you to understand a point here. Who are the people who's been spoken to here? كُلَّ مَنْ هَبَّ وَدَبْ. Who is the one who's able to bring it back to Allah and His Messenger? أَهْلُ الْعِلْمِ. So don't come and say, I'm opposing Abu Hanifa and al-Sha'bi and al-Zuhri. Who are you to oppose Abu Hanifa? Who are you to oppose Sha'bi? Who are you to oppose al-Zuhri? The A'imma. A'imma. They are mountains in knowledge. So here the people who are being spoken to are already mentioned in the verse, as Imam al-Qurtubi mentioned. Qurtubi said this is an ayah that shows that the people who bring it back to the Kitab and the Sunnah are the ulama, not the awamun nas, not the general mass. Are you with me? The general mass, they don't do that. The ahlul ilm are the ones. Because Allah just said, wa ulil amri minkum. And those who have authority on, on you, the scholars. And we're here, not, we are not opposing Abu Hanifa and Sha'bi and Zuhri with our understanding. We're opposing them with the view of the Jumhur. Sahih. The khilaf that's here is amongst the ulama, not amongst us and an alim. If it's us and an alim, our qawl la ibrata lahu. It has no consideration and it means nothing. Araftum? Good. Now that we've understood that if the scholars differ upon a matter, the kitab, it has to be brought back to the kitab and the sunnah. It has to be brought back to the kitab and the sunnah. Now that we've actually understood and we've comprehended that when khilaf occurs, what is the tariqah that a person needs to take? What's the path that he has to take? It is bringing back this dispute and this argument back to the kitab and the sunnah. And we said this is done by an alim, a person of knowledge. And not the awamun nas, not the general mass. But there's a question here now. A mas'ala that needs to be pointed out. Which is, at this particular point, that there is difference between two parties of scholars. Are they both right? You refer to both of them as correct? Or is there a right and a wrong? Is there a right and a wrong? The messenger. Are you with me, brothers? Before I mention the Prophet's hadith, before I mention it, the issues that a person has to understand is as follows. Some people, due to ignorance, due to lack of understanding, easily say, لا إنكار في مسائل الخلاف. They say there is no إنكار. There is no Inkar. Inkar could be what? What can we say inkar is? Huh? There is no rejecting, there is no rebuking, scolding. In matters which are what? In matters which are what? Khilaf. Now this is what? This is not right. One cannot say, La inkara fi masail khilaf. You can't say that. Yes, there is inkar in Masail al-Khilaf. Na'am. But what is correct is La inkara fi masail al-Ijtihad. La inkara fi masail al-Ijtihad. There is no inkar in issues of Ijtihad. Sah. Sahih. And there is a difference between the two. There's a difference between La inkara fi masail al-Khilaf and La inkara fi masail al-Ijtihad. Sahih. And the difference between the two is that لا إنكار في مسائل الخلاف is one group of people have a text and the other group of scholars are not using text in this particular issue.
Sahih.
So one of the groups are using a دليل. There's an evidence present in this argument on one party side. At this particular point, there is inkar of the group that's going against this dalil. As for la inkara fi masail ijtihad, that there's no inkar in issues of ijtihad, it means issue where there's no evidence for both parties. Or they are all relying on the same evidence. Are you there? But everyone is extracted from it a totally different understanding that the other one isn't. Sahih? A lot of the times, what enters this? Qadiyat al-tasahih wa tad'if al-hadith, weakening and strengthening hadith is ijtihad. No one of the parties actually has a dalil min kitabin or sunnah, ayah from the Quran or sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ to say that this hadith is, huh? He don't know. It's based on ijtihad. Have you followed the science correctly and have you not followed the science? This is ijtihad. That one, are you there? You can say, I believe this is right. As for then saying that the other opinion, when there's this issue is ijtihad, it's based on ijtihad. You're allowed to take a stance. But the other party's stance, you can't say it's batil. You can't say it's what? Munkar. Or fasid. You can say راجح المرجوح. صحيح. As for if there's an evidence in this issue, are you with me, brothers and sisters who are listening? Issues that have دليل present is called صحيح and فاسد. There's a correct opinion and there's a فاسد opinion, corrupt opinion, an incorrect opinion. Does that make sense? لكن listen. Can we then say that the one whose opinion goes against the evidence, what stance do we take regarding him? This is very important. His opinion is wrong, because there's dalil here. The one whose opinion is wrong will say his opinion is wrong, because he went against the evidence. Both parties can't be right when there's an evidence there. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا حَكَمَ الْحَاكِمُ فاجتهد ثم أصاب فله أجراني. If the scholar, he does ijtihad and he gets it right, he gets two reward. He strives in a ruling, he puts his hard work and effort in, he comes out with a final conclusion and he says this is the ruling, and then he gets it right, he then gets two reward. وإذا حكم, if he then strives, the second scholar is that he strives, he does ijtihad, he strives, he puts hard work and effort in, and then he gives a ruling on this issue, and then he gets it wrong. ثُبَّ أَخْطَأَ, he gets it wrong. فَلَهُ أَجْرٌ, he gets a reward for it. What does he get? But then look what the Prophet said, ثُمَّ أَخْطَأَ. The hadith is Sahihain, Bukhari Muslim. ثُمَّ أَخْطَأَ, and he gets it wrong. So we can say this is قول خطأ, wrong opinion. You can't say to me, لا إنكار في مسائل الخلاف. فيه إنكار. قول is فاسد or it's خطأ, it's wrong. And this قول is صحيح. The Prophet is saying this, عليه الصلاة والسلام. And not the statement of Al-Busiri where he said, وَكُلُّهُم مِّن رَسُولِ اللَّهِ مُلْتَمِسٌ غَرْفًا مِّنَ الْبَحْرِ أَوْ رَشْقًا مِّنَ الدِّيَمِ. That all of them kind of dipped from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Every scholar is kind of taking it from the Prophet one way or another. لا 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 لا. One is actually taking it from the Prophet's hadith and is used as an evidence, and the other one missed it. He got it wrong. And this is based on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's statement. And Imam Shafi'i said the same as well. In his Kitab al-Risala, he says, أَمَّا مَا دَلَّتْ عَلَيْهِ السُنَّةِ. Anything that the Sunnah shows, فَلَا حُجَّةَ فِي أَحَدٍ خَالَفَ قَوْلُهُ السُنَّةِ. There is no proof in anyone whose view or his statement goes against the Kitab and the Sunnah. There's no proof in that. You can't use that as an argument. Anything that the Sunnah shows, and then we have a scholar that goes against this Sunnah, فَلَا حُجَّةَ, there's no proof in this. You can't use this as an argument. In anybody, فِي أَحَدٍ خَالَفَ قَوْلُهُ السُنَّةِ, anyone whose statement goes against the Sunnah, there's no proof in his statement. You can't use this. Rather, Shaykh Imam Shafi'i, Imam Shafi'i, رحمه الله, as Ibn al-Qayyim brings in his kitab, إعلام الموقعين, that Ibn Imam Muhammad Ibn Idris al-Shafi'i, he brings ijma' on this issue. That there's no khilaf in this issue. Which is what? He says, أجمع الناس, أجمع المسلمون. Different copies, different wordings they use. أجمع الناس, the people have unanimously agreed upon. Scholars and the عوام الناس. It's an ijma. على أن من استبانت له سنة عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لم يكن له أن يدعها لقول أحد. It is by consent, unanimously agreed upon, that anybody who it becomes clear to him, the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam becomes clear to him. Some nusakh say لم يكون, some nusakh says لم يحل. It is not permissible for him أن يدعها لقول أحد. It is not permissible for him to leave it for the speech of anybody. Once it becomes clear to you that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said something, and there's a prophetic statement in this, or the Prophet did this, there's an action of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this issue, it is not permissible for you to oppose that with a view of a scholar. Abadan. Abadan, you can't. Rather, Abdullah ibn Abbas refused to take the opinion of Abu Bakr and Umar, who no imam is equal to the two of these. Abu Bakr and Umar, no one's like them in this ummah. They are the best after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ibn Abbas, he said, "Urahum sayahlikun." I see these people are going to be destroyed. "Urahum sayahlikun." These people, they're going to be destroyed. أقول قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. I am saying to them, the Prophet said. ويقول, and they say to me, نهى أبو بكر وعمر. Abu Bakr and Umar, both of them prohibit this. I'm saying to them that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam has said, and they are saying to me that Abu Bakr and Umar prohibited this. So what is he trying to say? Abu Bakr's and Umar's opinion is nothing في مقابلة النص في مقابلة النص in opposition to the Kitab and Sunnah. أراهم سيهلكون. Are you there? Can we then say Ibn Abbas was monopolizing the da'wah? Yeah? Abdullah ibn Abbas was trying to make everybody of one opinion and he wasn't respecting Umar and Abu Bakr and Umar. Can we say that? La. He saw that this mas'ala was la majala lil ijtihadi fi. He believed there was no door open to ijtihad. Why? There is a present evidence here for him. He has an ayah min kitabillah. He has an ayah from the Quran. And he has a prophetic sunnah. Abu Bakr. Ibn Abbas. Now that I've mentioned this, another thing I need to point out, which is in the muqaddimah, which is when scholars fall short in a view they've taken, they've done an ijtihad. We just stated the ijtihad, was it right or wrong? Wrong, mathalan. Can we state that the scholar's opinion is wrong? Na'am. We'll say he got it wrong. These zallat, or these hafawat, these shortcomings, these mistakes that these imams come with, or these ulama come with, the people, the tulabul ilm, the students of knowledge, the ammatul nas, or the people, general mass, they fall in one of four categories. When it comes to the zallatul ulama. And as you all know, Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, as Imam al-Darimi mentions in his Sunan, and Shaykh al-Albani authenticated in his Mishkat al-Masabih, and then Takhrij and Ta'aliq on it, Shaykh al-Albani, that Umar radiallahu anhu said, Three things they destroy Islam. They destroy the deen. And what are they? Zallatul alim, the shortcoming of a scholar. Wajidalul munafiqi bil Quran, and the argumentation of the hypocrite with the Quran, or using the Quran. The hypocrite using the Quran for his arguments. وَأَئِمَّةُ الْمُضِلُّونَ, and imams who are misguided. So the first one is زَلَّةُ الْعَالِمِ. The alim's shortcoming brings a dangerous path for the people. It's a fitna. So the people are one of four. Pay attention. There are what? Pay attention. One of four. Please pay attention to this. The first of those is the people who blindly follow him. In his correct opinion, they follow him in his correct opinions, and when he gets it wrong, they still follow him in it. They do not hold back every single thing that comes from this imam without doing any tamyiz, distinguishing between what's right and wrong. They take it all on board. That's a fitna for those group of people. Because they go against the ayat that we just mentioned. وَاتَّبِعُوا مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكُم مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا مِن دُونِهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ قَلِيلًا مَّا تَذَكَّرُونَ. The second is those who criticize, rather slander, the scholars for the shortcomings that they have come with. إِهْدَارُ مَكَانَتِهِ, they put his status and his position down for the shortcoming that he has come with and the mistake that he's come with. They want to forget all of the good that he's done. and his position. It's also a fitna for those people as well. The third, who are the correct one, is they take the haqq that he has mentioned, that's in accordance to the kitab and the sunnah, and the mistakes that he has, they don't accept it from him. They take all the correct opinions that he has come with, and the mistakes that he's fallen in, which he has opposed the kitab and the sunnah, they what? They don't take it from him. And also, they still remember his position and his status and his makana, how he should be dealt with and how he should still be loved and respected. And that he, the imam, here, who got it wrong, is still rewarded for his mistake. So he's between what? Either two rewards or one reward. They know that and they hold on to that. Those are three, right? The fourth, who is the worst of them all, the worst of them all, is he likes the opinions that are soft. All of those mistakes that the Imma do, he takes them and he makes a book out of it. He makes a madhab out of it. Zallatul ulama. Wherever imams go wrong and they do a mistake in, he writes that down and he makes it his own madhab. It's called tatabu'u rukhas. Tatabu'u rukhas is called. He follows those lead ways, huh? Those fatawa, he brings them together and he makes it a madhab for himself. Those are the four types of people there are when it comes to the mistakes and the shortcomings of the scholars. Al-Imam al-Shatibi dealt with this in his Kitab al-Muwafaqat. Ibn al-Qayyim in his I'lam al-Muwaqqi'in. So I'm going to read their nuqulat. Al-Imam al-Shatibi says in his Kitab al-Muwafaqat, he says, إِنَّ زَلَّةَ الْعَالِمِ, the mistake and the shortcoming of a scholar, لَا يَصِحُ اِعْتِمَادُهَا مِنْ جِهَا, it is not permissible for you to rely on it. From an angle, you are not allowed to rely on it. وَلَا الْأَخْذُ بِهَا تَقْلِيدًا لَهُ, and you're not allowed to take it from him blindly. لا يجوز. Say how powerful the statement is. وَذَلِكَ لِأَنَّهَا مَوْضُوعَةٌ عَلَى الْمُخَالَفَةِ لِلشَّرْعِ وَلِذَلِكَ عُدَّتْ زَلَّةٌ. The reason is because it is in opposition to the shara, the sharia. And that is why it was called a zalla, a shortcoming. So, when a scholar comes with a mistake, you can't say I'm a Hanafi, or I'm a Shafi'i, I'm a Maliki, I'm a Hanbali, so I have to still follow him in it. La. That's what Imam al-Shatibi is saying to you. Al-Imam Abu Ishaq al-Shatibi. He said to you, La. إن زلة العالم لا يصح اعتمادها من جهة ولا الأخذ بها تقليدا له, and it is not permissible for you to take it blindly following him, because it goes against the Sharia which you were commanded to follow. واتبعوا ما أنزل إليكم من ربكم ولا تتبعوا من دونه أولياء قليلا ما تذكرون. So that's, pay attention, that statement of Imam al-Shatibi is talking about what? Pay attention here. I have to understand the point that I'm bringing home. The first group of people who I said went wrong, where did they go wrong? Because of the status of the imam and the scholar and how much respect and love they have for him, they just took everything from him without any distinguishing. Sahih? And Imam al-Shatibi refuted that. That point, which is that mistake, we can't accept it from him, because it goes against the Sharia. Now we're going to be talking about the second group of people who went wrong. Which is what? What did they do? He got it wrong. They put him down, they threw him. You see? وَمَنْ ذَا الَّذِي تُرْضَى سَجَايَهُ كُلُّهَا كَفَى الْمَرْءِ نُبْلًا أَنْ تُعَدَّ مَعَيِبُ. Who is the person, if you count his mistakes, you're never going to find any shortcut. Who is the person that you're never going to find any mistakes in him? If you were to count, you look at his life. But you know what's very virtuous and great? The fact that you can count his mistakes. It shows you how great he is. It's when you can't count his mistakes when the problem arises. فالمرء لبلا أن تعد معايبه. That's honorable. That is virtuous. The fact that you, this Imam has been authoring for the last 60, 50 years, and all you've got on him is 5-6 mistakes. Allahu Akbar. We're talking about مسائل فقهية أصالة. Because these issues we're talking about مسائل فقهية. مسائل which are فروع. You see? Very important. So you do not put him down. And Imam Ibn al-Qayyim is going to talk about the position of the Imam, which is the second group where they went wrong. Which is because the mistake came, they went directly to the qail, the one who said this state speech, this noble imam, and so they started to slander him, and started to what? Belittle him. Ibn al-Qayyim says, مَنْ لَهُ عِلْمٌ بِالشَّرْعِ وَالْوَاقِعِ يَعْلَمُ قَطْعًا أَنَّ الرَّجُلَ الْجَلِيلَ الَّذِي لَهُ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ قَدَمُ صَالِحٌ وَآثَارٌ حَسَنًا وَهُوَ مِنَ الْإِسْلَامِ وَأَهْلِهِ بِمَكَانٍ قَدْ يَكُونُ مِنْهُ الْهَفْوَةُ وَالزَّلَّةُ هُوَ فِيهَا مَعْذُورٌ بَلْ مَأْجُورٌ لِاجْتِهَادِهِ. Ibn al-Qayyim says, anyone who has knowledge of the Sharia, and he also even knows the waqi', the current situation, he knows it very well. يعلم قطعا, he knows clearly. He knows with unwavering conviction. أن الرجل الجليل, the honorable person. That an honorable person. الذي له في الإسلام قدم صالح. One who has a position in Islam. He has a rank, has a status within the religion. He has آثار حسنة. He has left good things behind. He's produced a lot of work for the ummah. Are you with me? وهو من الإسلام وأهلي بمكان. And he in the hearts of the Muslim, he has a big position. He has a big place in the hearts of the people. He's an honorable person. قد يكون منه الهفوة والزلة. A shortcoming can come from that person. And a mistake can occur from him. هو فيها معذور. But he is excused for that mistake of his. Rather, he says, بل مأجور. Rather, he's rewarded for his mistake. لاجتهادي, for his striving that he has done. فلا. But look at this. That's him. That's his status. That is his rank. That is his rank. But what about the statement he just said? فَلَا يَجُوزُ أَن يُتَّبَعَ فِيهَا. Because we still love him, still respect him and honor him. But that doesn't mean فَلَا يَجُوزُ أَن يُتَّبَعَ فِيهَا. But it's not permissible for you to follow him in this opinion. Don't conflate and don't mistake the two for one another. Just because you said, I'm not going to take the statement from him, doesn't mean you're belittling him. Are you with me, brothers? فلا يجوز, it is not permissible, أن يتبع فيها, it is not permissible for you to follow him in it. ولا يجوز, and it is also, look at it, are you allowed to follow him in this mistake that he's done, this shortcoming? You're not allowed to. And you're also not allowed to. ولا يجوز أن تهدر مكانته, and you're not allowed to belittle him. You're not allowed to belittle him. You're not allowed to put him down. ومنزلته في قلوب المسلمين, in the hearts of the Muslims. You're not allowed to. Don't try to put him down. I've spoken about what? Spoke about three groups now. Spoke about three groups. The group that take everything. تَقْلِيدًا لَهُ. Shatibi responded to him. Ibn al-Qayyim responded to who? Both parties. Simultaneously. Automatically the third party comes out of it straight away. Which is what? The ones who stay away from the mistake and they also praise him, honor him, respect him, give him the position Allah Ta'ala gave him. Those three are mentioned. Now the fourth one is left. Those who follow the shortcomings, they only look for it. They only look for his shortcomings and they make that a view of theirs. And that is called تَتَبُّعُ الرُّخَص. تَتَبُّعُ الرُّخَص. They only want to follow the rukhas. And Imam Sulaiman al-Taymi, he said, إن أخذت برخصة كل عالم, if you take the رخصة of every scholar who comes with a رخصة, and an opinion where he's soft, he's lean, you just take those fatwas because it goes with هوا. اجتمع فيك الشر كله, all evil will be present in you. If what you do is, yeah, you say, is there a lean fatwa in this particular issue? There is. There's a lean view out there, soft, kind, you know. You can take mortgage. Some scholars who said you can. If you do that and you say, okay. And then some scholars who say, her music is halal. And then some scholars who say, huh, this is this. Write this all down for me. Fatwa. He brings a madhab, madhab. A madhab out of this. اجْتَبَعَ فِيكَ الشَّرُّ كُلُّهُ. ولذلك, there was an individual who, the Kutub al-Tarajum, they mention it. A person, are you with me? There was what? There was somebody who took all the rukhas of the ulama and he compiled it in a book and he brought it to one of the Muslim leaders. He brought it to one of the Muslim leaders and he said, this is it. Here you go. Just take this. And some of the scholars saw that and they said to the leader, do not follow this book. Do not take this book. Wallahi, this is zandaqa. This is heresy. Sahih? This is what? Heresy, heretic. So when you find a people just taking any other ruqsa, making a madhab of his, some scholars said you can have be musbal al-izar. Scholars said you can cut your beard if you want to. You can take mortgage if you want to. You could marry without the condition of the consent of the guardian. You could. He takes all of those opinions. اجْتَمَعَ فِيكَ الشَّرُّ كُلُّهُ. Ibn Abd al-Barr is the one who wrote the statement of Sulaiman al-Taymi in his kitab Jam'u Bayan al-Ilmi. وفضل. Right after he brings it, he says this. He says, هذا إجماع لا أعلم فيه خلافا. الله أكبر. He said, this statement of Sulaiman al-Taymi is a consensus, it's an إجماع. And I do not know any difference of opinion regarding this. Which is, if you take the rukhsa of every scholar, evil is present in you. Evil is what? Evil is present in you. Very good. Al-Imam al-Awza'i, who's Imam Ahli al-Sham. Who is he? Imam Ahli al-Sham. He said, من أخذ بنوادر العلماء خرج من الإسلام. Anyone who takes the strange opinions of scholars, he takes those rare, strange opinions of the scholars, he takes those. خرج من الإسلام. He leaves what? He leaves, huh? He leaves Islam. If you start taking all of those opinions, you see that person becomes a disbeliever tomorrow. He'll leave the religion. So is this a very dangerous issue? It's a very dangerous issue. That's why it's very serious when it comes to this issue of how to deal with zallatul alim, the shortcomings that come from scholars. But pay attention, I have to mention this particular point. Sometimes a people attribute to a imam a mistake and they say, this is a zalla from the scholar. Sahih? And they say, this is a hafwa from him, a shortcoming from him. But in reality, it falls under the statement of the poet, وَكَمْ مِنْ عَائِبٍ قَوْلًا صَحِيحًا وَآفَتْهُ مِنَ الْفَهْمِ السَّقِيمِ. How many criticize and blame a person, but in reality, the problem is not with the one who's been blamed or the one that's been criticized. It's with the one who is trying to understand the statement of the one who is criticizing. It's you're having deficiency in understanding. You're the one who's suffering in a lack of comprehension. So it's important that the scholars are the ones who say that this is a zalla from this alim. And not every man kulla, laysa kulla man habba wa dab. Not every single person. An imam who's a muhaqqiq will say that. Na'am. He is the one who will say this. Because sometimes views are attributed to an imam which he didn't even hold. Sahih? He didn't even hold this opinion. Or he's been attributed to this opinion, and rather he's the one who's writing this opinion. He's actually writing this opinion. It's not even a zalla, it's a sahih. It's qawl al-rajih in the issue. So there is importance of observing all of that. Last but not least, the scholars, the imams, Imam Abu Hanifa, Al-Imam al-Sha'bi, Amr ibn al-Sha'bi, Al-Imam Muhammad ibn al-Shihab al-Zuhri, these three noble imams that you've mentioned, what is it that they've relied on? What brought them to the conclusion that a woman can get married to a man without the consent of her guardian? What's their proof? What did they use? Because what we all agree upon, that an Imam Abu Hanifa is an alim haqqan, who put the kitab and the sunnah before anything else. The same applies with Sha'bi, The same applies with Imam Zuhri. So what is their argument?
Sahih?
What is their argument in which they have come to the conclusion that a woman can get married without the consent of her, without the consent of her guardian? Their evidence is, if a woman goes to a shop, is she allowed to buy product? Is she allowed to buy something from a market? Is she also allowed to sell in the market? Can she? Are you with me? Can a woman buy and sell? Is she allowed to buy something? And is she allowed to sell something that belongs to her? Can she? Are you with me? Can she? They said, it's the same. She can give herself out. Just like she can sell a product of hers. That she has حق التصرف, the way she's allowed to deal with her own products and she's allowed to sell it, she's also permitted to give herself out. And she can get married to whoever she sees fit. But pay attention, there's something I have to mention. Imam Abu Hanifa, and Imam Az-Zuhri, and Imam Sha'bi rahimahullah, rahimahumullah jami'an, they all believe that she has to be kuf. They have to be equal to one another. She can't be a 20-year-old,
sahih,
marrying a man who's from a different land. She doesn't understand his dialect or what he's speaking about, and he's old. Huh? There has to be this. They have to be kuf, equal to one another. There has to be what? There has to be kuf. They both have to be equal to one another. They have to be compatible, basically. There has to be compatibility. But as for the guardian having to be the condition, they said that's not a condition. So now my question to you is, brothers and sisters, what was the evidence of Imam Abu Hanifa and Al-Sha'bi and Al-Zuhri? What's their evidence? It's called Qiyas. They done a Qiyas analogy. They done a what? An analogy, a Qiyas, to give the ruling of the permissibility of a woman getting married without the consent of her guardian. So this is, pay attention, this is very powerful. It's very powerful. So we have Abu Hanifa, we have Al-Sha'bi, and we have Al-Imam Al-Zuhri, rahimahumullah jami'an, on this side saying our evidence is Qiyas. Because that's what they brought analogy. Qiyas is when there's a hukum, there's an asl, there's a fara'. Are you with me? And there's a illatun jami'atun baynahuma. Sahih? That's their argument. Their argument was, can she sell and buy her phone products? Yes. Same she can do with herself. That's it. Now we look at the Jumhur. We say to you, what's your evidence? What's your evidence? The Jumhur say we have Kitab, we have Sunnah, we have Athar al-Sahaba, and we have Aqwal al-Ulama al-Mutaqaddimin wal-Mutakhirin. We have Aqwal of the Ulama, Qarnan ba'da Qarn, generations after generations. Meaning Aqwal of the Tabi'in and the Tabi'u Tabi'in. We have their Aqwal. Okay. Now, what's the situation? How do we get out of this situation now? First, we said Abu Hanifa's status cannot be put down. لا تهدر مكانته. The Ummah are متفقون, unanimous in agreement. جلالته, his nobility and his status. The same is with Sha'bi. The same is with Zuhri. Are you with me? But how is it that we deal with them? The way we deal with them is فلا يجوز أن يتبع. We can't follow them in this mistake now. Why can't we follow them in this mistake? Because they have fallen into something known as قياس مع النص فاسد الاعتبار. قياس analogy here. They have an analogy. مع النص with text. كتاب السنة إجماع here. أما كتاب السنة not إجماع. كتاب السنة is what's here. And of course, they even got more. They got Athar al-Sahaba and they got Aqwal al-Mutaqaddimin wal-Mutaakhirin. But here we have Al-Kitab al-Sunnah for now. Okay? And here we have Qiyas. The Qa'ida is Al-Qiyasu ma'a an-Nassi fasid al-Ihtibar. Their statement is fasid al-Ihtibar. It is null and void.
صحيح.
It falls under the quote that scholars say, إِذَا جَاءَ نَهْرُ اللَّهِ بَطَلَ نَهْرُ النِّعْقَلِ.
صح.
إِذَا جَاءَ نَهْرُ اللَّهِ بَطَلَ نَهْرُ النِّعْقَلِ. If the river of Allah comes, then the river of Mi'qal becomes null and void. For example, there's a village or a town or a desert. Are you with me, brothers? Pay attention. There was a man called Mi'qal. Mi'qal. There's a man called Mi'qal. He had a little place where he kept water. Okay? So the people would come to him and they would drink from him. And he would charge them for it. Are you with me? He would what? He would charge them for it. But he would make money out of it. Brothers, are you with me? If Allah brings rain, and the whole land becomes full of rain, and they get rain from high above, and then a river is made in front of them, or a little lake, or a pond, will they go to Mi'qal? Mi'qal is by. Allah's water came now, alhamdulillah. The same is, إِذَا جَاءَ الدَّلِيلُ بَطَلَ الْقِيَاسُ. When the dalil comes, then the qiyas and everything that was being, the ijtihad that was being done, بَطَلَ, null and void. We don't look at it. We don't look at it. Inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to conclude there بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ الْكَرِيمِ for now. And this was the muqaddimah, an introduction. So inshallah ta'ala, next sit, we're going to be speaking about حكم النكاح بدون الولي. What is the ruling of a woman getting married without the consent of her guardian? Anything which I have said that was wrong, فإنه مني ومن الشيطان والله ورسوله بريئان من. Is from me and Shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.